because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example we should follow his steps. He did no sin, neither was any guile found in his mouth. When he was reviled, didn't revile again. When he suffered, he threatened not. But he committed himself to him that judges righteously. His own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. For we all were like sheep who had gone astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. Amen. Praise God. This is what really what I want to share on this morning. Praise God. What we have really again in this chapter, especially Peter's been talking about the fact that we as the church are God's holy nation. I'm going to have to shout this morning. Praise God. Royal priesthood. Special people. We are called these wonderful things. God has called us out. And he says that we're called out of darkness into his marvelous light. And we're called to show forth the praise of him who has called us out of that. Amen. Peter then goes on to say that we are strangers and pilgrims in this world. In other words, we're in the world, but we're looking towards something greater. We're looking towards heaven and eternity, and we're not living for the now and the temporal. And much of the New Testament really does focus on that, the fact that we're called to live our lives in the world, but not of the world, and just being able to see beyond the temporal into the eternal. And he then says, in light of this, he says that we're called to fight against, subdue those lusts of the flesh which war against the soul, and just to live in accordance with that calling. And he then says also that our life, that we are seen by the Gentiles, by the world around us, and they may, by our good conversation, our good manner of life, come to glorify God in the day of visitation. So Peter then, he's talked about our calling, he's talked about these things, and then he begins then to define in more exact terms what it means to be a Christian and a believer in life. And he talks about how to respond to civil authorities, how to respond, in the church amongst the what he calls the brotherhood, how to and then respond in a situation of work or employment. He'll go on in chapter 3 to talk about the home, the husband and the wife. Praise God. And he's just basically just giving us how to live out our lives in everyday life, because again, Christianity is not so much just, it's not just a religion. It's not just about something you do on a Sunday. It's a way of living. The Bible says, in Old Testament and New Testament, that the just shall live by faith. So it's a life. It governs every area of our life. Praise God. And we want to have a living faith, which is, just governing and part of every area of our life. And this morning we're just looking here again at the situation really of employment. In verse 18, Peter talks about servants being subject to your masters. The first thing we want to say, in our contemporary world, we don't really normally use those terms. Back in the end days, they used different terms. There was slavery that went on, and we're not going to talk this morning about the rights and wrongs of slavery. But again, he basically says, servant, be subject to your masters. And we don't really call people today so much master. You know, we don't normally see ourselves as servants, but the same basic principle applies in a business or employment, where you have an employer and an employee. You know, where you have different levels of authority within a corporation or a business or a firm, whatever it is, and we could apply the same principles to that. You know, we could just as well say, you know, employees, be subject to your employers with all fear. And that word fear means reverence, you know, respect. It's not saying to be afraid of people, but it's saying to have a respect for the person, for the authority, to reverence them for their authority. And then he says, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward, which is an old English word, which basically probably means something like awkward or difficult. You know, and he's basically saying, no one, we all know how easy it is to, you know, to get along with and respect and honor people who treat us well, but it's harder to do it when somebody's treating us bad and difficult, and they have a, you know, a difficult personality. I'm sure we can all relate to situations in life and work, or you're some colleague or boss who's, you know, just difficult to get along with. And but the Bible says to respect that all people, you know, no matter how they treat us, you know, no matter what their temperament is or their personality is, praise God. And he says that this is thankworthy if a man for conscience towards God endures grief and even suffers wrongfully. So sometimes you can even suffer wrongfully in employment, and but Peter says that this is it's a good thing if you're able to do this, and you know, because of your conscience towards God, because of your God fearing, you want to obey God, and you're willing to, you know, resist the temptation to respond in the flesh and to respond and get your revenge or whatever. You know, you're actually more interested in obeying God. And then Peter says, you know, for what glory is it, verse 20, if you are buffeted, well, at least to use the word disciplined or punished for your wrongdoing, if you take it patiently. But if you do well and suffer for it and take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. In other words, you know, if we are doing wrong in any area of life or in employment, and we receive discipline because of that wrongdoing, And we take it patiently, there's no real praise in that. You know, there's no commendation before God. You know, we're just basically receiving what we deserve. But if we are innocent and we still suffer wrong, and we still are treated in a wrong way, and we take it patiently, then that is commendable before God. Because in doing that, you're actually, as Peter will go on to say, you're actually showing, you're actually being like Christ. Hallelujah. Now, I know, like, you know, this is difficult. Praise God. This is one of those areas of Scripture that, you know, you have to kind of bribe somebody to get an amen, you know. You know, praise God. But, you know, it is difficult, and I admit it myself. I'm not one who's, you know, probably the perfect example of this. You know, we all have flesh, and when somebody says something to you, it's difficult not to respond, you know, to say something back. Or when you feel like you're mistreated, you know, your flesh says, no, I want, you know, justice. I want to fight my case, fight my corner. I want, you know, revenge. I want to, you know, basically the flesh wants to rise up and get justice and get things to be made right and to get your name cleared and whatever it is. But Peter says, if you just kind of trust God, take it patiently, you know, that is commendable. And I think he probably had maybe more, he might have had in mind a situation in particular where somebody's being maybe mistreated because of their faith, because that would have been common at this time, as even it can happen today. It can happen in our society, but it happens certainly in a probably a greater way amongst societies where the national religion would be different than Christianity. You know, places like Pakistan or India, you hear stories about, you know, Christians who are mistreated and they're treated like second-class citizens because of their faith, and they're maybe mistreated in their areas of employment. And again, that's where they're called just to be patient and to be Christ-like. And in doing that, that actually could serve to witness to and to speak to the conscience of the person that is perpetrating the evil. Yeah. People will start to think, you know, this person here is different. He's not responding like everybody else. And that'll make them think about, you know, this person maybe, this faith is real. This faith is real. Praise God. So Peter here is saying this. He then go on to use the example of Christ. But before that, I just want to just also read out Romans chapter 12, where Paul says something similar. Same idea, just different wording. But Romans chapter 12. Verse 14. Praise the Lord. Paul says, to bless them that persecute you, bless and curse not. So we say, when somebody persecutes you, you know, bless them. You know, instead of cursing, you know, again, the natural response or reaction would be to curse them or to want to persecute them back. But he says to bless them, to rejoice with them that do rejoice, weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind, one towards another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Slightly different than what we're talking about, but, you know, it just says, don't be a big shot. You know, there's no big shots in God's kingdom. Praise God. Condescend to men of low estate. You know, it doesn't matter who you are, what title you have. Praise God. Verse 17, you know, he says, recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. So he says again, don't repay evil for evil. If you're mistreated, don't respond with evil. If it is possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men. It's not all possible. Some people are just, they're just bent on war and on conflict, you know. And but he says, as much as is possible, endeavor to, and as much as it depends upon you, then live peaceably with all men. And he says, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I repay, saith the Lord. In other words, when you're just not responding, what you're doing is it's actually an act of faith where you're just trusting God to take care of the situation. You know, it's not like you're, you know, whenever you don't seek personal revenge, you're basically just trusting God. You know, God, I leave him in your hands. You know, you do whatever you endeavor to be right. You know, and person may get saved or just leave it with God to whatever he does. And he says in verse 20, if your enemy hunger, you know, it doesn't say leave him hungry. It says to feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, he will reap coals of fire on his head. So in other words, just keep on blessing him. Keep on doing good. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen. I like that verse 21 because it's basically saying that you can overcome evil with good. People can come with evil, they can come with their all their weapons of evil and forces of evil, but you know, goodness actually overcomes evil. Praise God. Overcome evil with good. And basically, it's saying there basically that we have a choice of how we respond to people or situations in life. When somebody does something bad to you, you can either be overcome by that or you can overcome it with good. Amen. And I know in our society we have there's often a victim's mentality where people will say, well, that person does this because of the way he was treated. Maybe he was his father left him when he was young, and that's why he's, going around and ratting and abusing people. And it's almost like they justify it, But wrong is wrong. I understand people can have difficult circumstances, but you still can choose how you respond to your circumstances and the things that happen in life. Things that happen to you are not an excuse for wrong behavior. The Bible doesn't give you that excuse. We are accountable before God for our own actions, despite what other people may have done or said to us. And God will give us, especially as believers, we have grace by the Holy Spirit to overcome evil with good. And if we have been mistreated, abused, hurt, whatever it is, then God will give us the grace to overcome that with good, with forgiveness. And there's blessing in that, there's healing in that, amen. And whenever your person's bitter and offended, then that actually, you're the one that's bound up. Often the other person's just going away, happy as Dixie whistling away, and you're the one that's actually suffering. You're the one that's, bitter and depressed about it and hurt about it. Whenever you learn to forgive and release, then it brings these positive emotions. It brings peace, it brings joy of the Lord, it brings strength and fellowship with Him. Amen. Praise God. So, hallelujah. And again, as Paul says, as Peter says, going back to Peter again, when we do these things, we then, again, we are behaving as Christians, because to be a Christian is to be a follower of Christ. And Peter says in verse 21, for even hereunto ye were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. So in other words, whenever you look at the cross and the life of Christ, and especially the cross, it's not just, it is of course our place of redemption, our place of salvation, but it's also an example of somebody who was willing to endure suffering because of obedience to God, who was innocent, yet he still was willing to endure suffering. And he is an example that we should follow in his steps. In fact, Jesus says to the disciples, if you want to follow me, you've got to be willing to take up your cross and follow. You've got to be willing to deny yourself. If you're still in love with your own life and your own comforts, then you've got to die to that. You've got to be willing to take up your cross, follow me. He that loves his life will lose it. But the person that loses his life for my sake, he will find it. Praise God. So there is that loss of life, loss of personal interest and concern, just to embrace and to find the life of Christ. As Paul says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but yet not me, but I live as Christ living in me. He says in verse 22, again, speaking of Jesus as our example, that he didn't do any sin, neither was there any guile in his mouth. Praise God. When he was revived, he didn't revive again. Or when he was reviled, sorry, he didn't revile back. When he suffered, he didn't threaten, but he committed himself to him that judges righteously. Again, that's what Paul says, you know, again, vengeance is to the Lord. Let the Lord deal with, you know, let the Lord deal with it, whatever he wants to do. And really, what Peter here is Peter's actually drawn from a very famous Old Testament prophecy. I'm sure you might know what it is. You know, it's Isaiah 53. He's talking, he's drawn from the parable, or from the prophecy of the suffering servant. He's taken Isaiah's prophecy and he's applying it again to us and to Christ as our example. And again, he's saying he didn't do any sin. There wasn't any guilt or anything wrong in his mouth. And when he was reviled, he didn't revile back. And we see this here in the gospel accounts. You know, we see that time where Jesus is taken. He's beaten severely. And he just commits himself to that. You know, he's provoked. They place a crown of thorns upon him, you know, a scarlet robe, and they begin to mock him and, you know, worship, and like mock worship, saying, you know, you're the king and what have you. And they begin to just mock him as the king. You know, even on the cross, they're saying, you know, if you're the Son of God, then, you know, bring yourself down from the cross. All these things are saying just to, you know, to mock him, to revile him. But he never responded back. He never, you know, assaulted them, or just committed himself, you know, to the will of God. You know, he was spat upon, beaten, all these things. Praise God. And you think to yourself, you know, this is amazing. You have to remember too that, you know, that Jesus himself says that I have the power to call down, you know, 12 legions of angels. And, you know, the commentator said that in one legion there's like 6,000 angels, so that's like 72,000 angels. So at any time, Christ had the power to call down 72,000, that's probably only a small number, but 72,000 angels to bring deliverance to him. You know, yet he was willing to resist that temptation. He was willing to, you know, take things into his own hands as the Son of God, but he was willing to submit himself to this, you know, abuse. And you think, you know, this is the Son of God being abused by his, you know, creation, and he was willing to do it. And even his actions in itself were a witness to those around him, because we have, you know, a thief on the cross. He actually recognized that he was the Son of God. He recognized that he was going to have a kingdom. And he says, Lord, remember me whenever you come and establish your kingdom. You know, he recognizes something different about this man. There's also a Roman centurion, and he actually realized that this is the Son of God, and he, you know, could have well been converted as well. Praise God. So, you know, this is Jesus' actions, you know, spoke. Hallelujah. You know, we're just thinking of as well of in Acts where Stephen also was stoned. And Stephen said, you know, don't lay this sin to their charge. You know, he dealt in mercy and forgiveness. And there was one standing beside him called, you know, Saul of Tarsus. You know, and of course he became convicted, you know, and you know the story with Saul. He became the Apostle Paul. Hallelujah. This is the example of Jesus. And, you know, and somebody might then ask the question, you know, how can somebody who's so holy and powerful and great as Jesus, as the Messiah, as the Son of God, you know, subject himself to such treatment of man? What seems like weakness, it seems like, you know, defeat, it seems like that he's been overcome. And even the disciples, many of them, they fled away because they thought, this is not the way it's meant to be. You know, this is like, he thought this, he's going to set up his kingdom. Here he is, he's on a cross, he's being defeated by the Romans, he's being abused by men. How can the Son of God allow this? You know, it seems like defeat. It seems like he's been overcome. But then Peter begins to answer the reasons why. Peter says that in verse 24, reasons why, that on the cross he was actually bearing our sins in his own body on the tree. That he was being bruised for our healing. That we were the sheep that had gone astray, and he was doing it on our behalf. It was, the word is substitutionary. You know, if you're watching a football match and they bring on a substitute, there's somebody that goes on behalf of another player. He gets tired, or he gets, you know, he's not playing very well, he gets injured. Take him off, put on a substitute. Somebody that's fresh, you know, somebody that's ready to, you know, somebody that's put on in place of another. And on the cross, Jesus was like, he was our substitute. It was a substitutionary sacrifice. He committed himself to the cross because of us. Amen. Because we were the ones who deserved to go there. Amen. We were the ones who were under the sentence of death by the righteous judge who deserved condemnation. But Christ was the one who came along and says, you know, I will suffer their death penalty. I will endure their sentence. I will assume their guilt and their sins upon myself. And I will die in their place, that they can then be released and have forgiveness. Praise God. So this is the cross. As Pastor Alan was saying this morning, this is why we take communion. And the Lord says, you know, to do this in remembrance of me. And until he comes again, this is what we're called to do, to always, you know, remember the cross. Again, on the cross, Peter's again quoting from Isaiah. He who has his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree. And Jesus bore our sins. And that word bore or bear means to carry, you know, to carry up, to bear up. He took our sins upon himself. This is a wonderful thing. And now all the sins that we've committed, the sin that is our very being, our very nature, the sins that we commit, you know, whether in the past and even all sins that we could ever commit, you know, past, present, future, it was all placed upon Jesus on the tree. The very essence of sin, the nature of sin, he became sin on that tree. He became us on that tree. And God then punished, our punishment was then placed upon Jesus. As Paul says to the Galatians, quote from Deuteronomy, you know, he that was on the tree was cursed, because it's written, you know, that everybody that hangs on a tree is subject to the curse of God. And the punishment, the wrath, the curse, you know, God's righteous anger and hostility and punishment of sin was absorbed into the body and person of Jesus. He became sin, hallelujah, on the cross. And that's why even the very creation became dark. Even the very sun would not shine upon that sin-cursed body of Jesus. And as he just took that weight of sin, and he just, for the first time, experienced, you know, death and separation from the Father. He says, you know, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he just experienced the emptiness, loneliness, the darkness of death and separation from God, you know, that sin brings. Hallelujah. He became sin, But that's only half the story, thank God. No, he became sin that we who were sinners could be made righteous. It was like an exchange. And it was a pretty good deal for us. Now, Jesus took our sin, and he, in return, gave us his righteousness. He bore our sins on the tree. But that's not where it ends. There's a counter effect that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness. Amen. See, Jesus took our sins, and you know the cross was a place of separation. Jesus took our sins, and he died with our sins. And we are then called to by faith see our sins as on the cross with Jesus. You know, and the power of sin is broken because you know Jesus absorbed it. Jesus died with our sin. Jesus took our sin and took it to a place of death, a place of burial. But like us, he was raised up from the dead. We can also then, in him, walk in newness of life. You read about it in Romans chapter 6, and it's really a reference, you know, when you're getting baptized, you know, we are baptized into the likeness of his death. That in the same manner that he died, he was buried, but he also rose up from the dead, and we also then partake in his new life. We died with him, we were buried with him in baptism, and then we also rise up with him, a new creation, new life, resurrection. We're new people, we walk in a new life, you know, there's a separation. And we're then called to reckon ourselves then to be dead to sin. And that's not, you know, automatic. You know, the flesh still has that. The sin is still present within us. You know, we're not yet glorified people. You know, we will be someday by God's grace. But sin is still present within us. But we are called to, by faith in Christ, reckon ourselves to be dead to sin. And through faith in him, through looking to Jesus and to his cross, to his work, we're able to find, you know, the grace from God, the power and grace from the Spirit to overcome, to walk in the victory of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's a daily battle, a daily struggle. Sometimes, you know, we can get the better of you, praise God, but you know, we are called, this is our, you know, we are able by the grace of God. And it comes again, partly it comes by faith, not by what you feel, but by faith, looking away from yourself and your own faults and failures. It's not about trying, it's not just about trying to get better, trying to be a better person. I know myself, you know, I can never come to a place of being this perfect person in myself. You know, I say in the flesh, you know, you're always going to be, you know, sinful and weak in many ways. And every day you're just aware of the reality of your weakness, of your sinfulness. But it's when I, you know, get out of myself and look to the cross and look to Christ and say, Lord, you know, you be my strength. You know, you be my righteousness. You be my purity and power for right living. You be my strength every day. I look to you for the faith, for the moral strength, for the virtue, for the goodness. I look to your power, to your cross, to your resurrection. Then that's where the victory is found. You know, looking away from yourself and looking on to Jesus. You know, identifying with him. Hallelujah. Praise God. So he says it again. So as Peter's saying here, he on the cross became sin in his body, on the tree, became cursed, that in consequence that we could then live as dead to sins and live, you know, righteously. And he says at the very end of this verse, you know, by whose stripes you were healed. That's again quoting from Isaiah. By whose stripes or bruises you were healed. And I believe, you know, the context here, there's a clear reference to, you know, an inner and a spiritual healing, to a forgiveness of sins, being healed from the mark of sin, the injury of sin. You see, sin leaves a mark and leaves a stain and leaves an injury, but God brings forgiveness and healing. Praise God. But of course, the word also refers to even to physical healing. And, you know, and that's found in Matthew's Gospel, where the Holy Spirit inspires Matthew to quote the same verse, it's the same prophecy in reference to Jesus' ministry of physically healing the people in his midst. So it has a physical reference, but you see, you know, it's all one really. You know, God's, Jesus' work on the cross, forgiveness, healing, it's all together. The psalmist says, you know, the Lord forgives all our iniquities and heals all our diseases. And I know we can suffer, we can struggle with sins, we can struggle with affliction in our body, praise God, but, you know, let's not lose hope. Let's keep our faith in Christ, who has both defeated sin and was bruised for our healing. You know, let's look to him for the strength to be healthy and to be healed both in spirit, mind, and body. Hallelujah. Christ is a all-conquering Messiah. Hallelujah. And it says in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 6, referring to the ministry of the Messiah, the Lord, he says that God's, the Father is actually talking to the Son, to the Messiah, to the what Isaiah calls, you know, the righteous servant. When he says, I, the Lord, have called thee in righteousness, and will hold your hand, and will keep you, and give you for a covenant of the people, for a light of the Gentiles, to open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. Hallelujah. That's the ministry of Christ, the Messiah. He comes to open the blind eyes, spiritually, physically. He comes to heal, both inwardly and outwardly. You know, because, you know, sin, you know, everything has its root in sin. You know, and forgiveness and healing come together. Amen. Praise God. Jesus died for all, you know, for sins, and for our well-being, for our wholeness. Hallelujah. And the same faith that we look, you know, towards for the cross, for forgiveness, also look for, you know, emotional and physical well-being. Hallelujah. For healing from the effects of sin, from the guilt and from the stains and from the mark of sin. Because, you know, sin is, it's not just, sin is devastating, amen. It's not just about the fact that sin is, you know, God is just up in heaven and saying, no, don't do this, don't do that. You do this here, you get a slap here. You know, it's not, you know, it's, sin is death. You know, it is darkness, it is death, and it just darkens the heart, darkens the soul. You know, leads to things happening in the flesh. That doesn't mean every fleshly infirmity is a result of some personal sin, but, you know, in a general sense, whether it's personal, whether it's just because of Adam, you know, we all have experienced sin and its effects, but there is blessing, there is healing in Christ. Hallelujah. By whose bruises we were healed. And then, in conclusion then, Peter says, again from Isaiah, for we all are sheep. We all were a sheep going astray, but on my return to the great shepherd and bishop of our soul. Amen. And that really does described, praise God, you know. This is a common biblical term, you know. They were agricultural people. They talked about shepherds and sheep. And if you know anything about sheep, you know, they are prone to wandering. So they need, they're not, you know, they can be a bit kind of, not the right word is, but, you know, they need a shepherd. They need somebody to guide them, to protect them, to lead them beside the green fertile grass, beside the still waters, to bring them out of the valley of the shadow of death, the places of danger, as the psalmist says. You know, the Lord is our shepherd. He brings us through, amen. He brings us through those dark valleys. He leads us to those fertile fields. You know, he will give us, you know, goodness and mercy all the days of our life. You know, he will fill our cup to running over. He is our shepherd. Hallelujah. He is the great shepherd of Israel, the great shepherd of his people, of his church. Hallelujah. The Lord is our shepherd. And Jesus himself, the great shepherd in the flesh, you know, picks up from this shepherd illustration and picks up from Isaiah and says, you know, I am sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I am sent to seek and save that which is lost, to fetch the lost sheep. I mean, you come to John chapter 10, I'm not looking at it this morning, but you had this great passage about, you know, Christ is really saying, it's all about him as the shepherd. You know, and he's pulling from Ezekiel, pulling from the old covenant, where Jehovah was the shepherd. And he's saying, you know, I am the good shepherd. You know, I am the one. I'm not like the hireling that comes to, you know, doesn't care about the flock. You know, the thief that comes to kill and destroy. I am the good shepherd. I come to give my life for the sheep. You know, I am the good shepherd. I am the one who will gather the sheep, both from the Jewish fold, both from the Gentile fold, where there'll be one great fold, one great, you know, shepherd and one great fold. The Lord says, I am the good shepherd. I am the one who will protect you. He will guide you. You know, nobody will snatch you out of my hands. I will protect you. These are the blessings, you know, that are given to the sheep. You know, and basically a sheep is somebody that's then defined by somebody who hears God's voice and follows it. Just like in the natural, you know, a sheep will hear the voice of the shepherd. Every shepherd has got a whistle or a call or, you know, whatever it is, a claps of hand, whatever it is, and those sheep recognize the voice of the shepherd. And in the same way, you know, the Christ's sheep are those that hear his voice and they follow. They don't follow the voice of the stranger. They follow the voice of Christ. They're his sheep. And therefore then, because they follow him, because they belong to him, because they're his sheep, and he as the shepherd, he leads them, guides them, feeds them, protects them, and blesses him. That's what Peter here is saying. Now, we were sheep that had gone astray, but we have now returned unto the shepherd and the bishop. And that's another word. That's the overseer of our souls. Christ is the great pastor, the great bishop, the great overseer of our souls. Hallelujah. And I'll just close with just one reading. Ezekiel 34, verse 11, where I just want to show you how that Christ is the great shepherd and how that he fulfills these Old Testament prophecies. And we'll just close down. Ezekiel 34, verse 11. You know, Ezekiel is talking about the false shepherds, the idol shepherds that come to steal, to kill from the flock. They come to abuse the flock. But he says in verse 11, speaking of Christ, the Messiah, For thus says the Lord God, behold, I, even I, will both search out my sheep and I will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock in the day, that he is amongst the sheep that are scattered, so will I seek out my sheep. I will deliver them out of all places where they have been scattered in the cloud and dark day. And I will bring them from the people, and gather them from all the countries where, and will bring them to their own land, and feed them upon the mountains of Israel. by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in a good pasture upon a high mountain of Israel. That shall their fold be. There they shall lie in a good fold, in a fat pasture. There they shall feed upon the mountains of Israel. I will feed my flock. I will cause them to lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek that which was lost, again the words of Jesus, and bring again that which was driven away. I will bind up that which was broken in Christ's ministry, and I will strengthen that which was sick. Hallelujah. Again, he brings healing, praise God, by his stripes. And I will destroy the fat on the straw, and I will feed them with judgment. In other words, those that abuse. This is the good shepherd. Hallelujah. Praise God. So we have a good shepherd. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's really this morning's teaching. Praise God. I hope you've been blessed and encouraged. Hallelujah.